Okay, chapter 18, the rise of Russia. And we'll be looking at Russia's expansion and politics under the Tsars, Russia's first westernization, and the themes in early modern Russian history. All right, Russia's expansion, 14th century, they will remove the Mongol threats, and that will be through the hierarchy in Moscow. Moscow's going to start to prosper because of the church and because of it becoming a trading center in that area, connecting the Far East with getting into Eastern Europe and even parts of Western Europe, so it became a trading center. The nobles will rise up and they're able to remove the Mongol threat. And Ivan III the Great will make it an independent state in 1480 using the Orthodox Christianity as support. The need for revival, obviously the Mongols had, while they had a lot of positive attributes, some of the negative things was a lack of manufacturing and industry, and also a period of cultural and economic decline, literacy declines. There wasn't as much urbanization in the cities as there was in other areas. And so Russia is a little bit behind some of the other areas, as we've seen with the growth of Western Europe. Ivan III will restoration of traditional rule, role overseeing the church. We've talked about that, kind of similar to the Caesaropapism. Remember, they were influenced by the Byzantine Empire earlier on before the Mongol threat. Russia as the Third Rome. So they were claiming themselves as the Third Reich. Ivan IV the Terrible attacks the boyars and the nobles and kind of giving more of a stronger hold to the Tsar's position in Russia. And this will be the beginning of this. The first family will be the Romanov family. Patterns of expansion. Expansion into Central Asia, into Siberia by 1500. They'll use the Cossacks to go down to the Baltic region and out to Siberia. These were peasants who were recruited. They'll be given land in these areas and military service and agricultural service to help support these areas. Large grants were given to nobles and bureaucrats at this time to push out to these areas. And trade with Asia is going to increase as they expand over into the Siberian area. And Islam will be tolerated. You don't have a heavy conversion, but those in the area, especially up in some of the border countries, it will be tolerated. Here's the map. I would understand the expansion of Russia. It's always good to understand your maps. It will help you in the AP exam. All right, Western contact with the Romanov policy, international turn to the West. Ivan III will have embassies to Western states. Ivan IV will begin trading with the British Empire. He will bring over some Italian artists and work on churches in the Kremlin. This is the kind of the dome-like structure that you're going to have. The book compared it to an onion. Ivan IV dies without an heir, and you're going to have a time of troubles, and the boyars are going to attempt to take power, remember the nobles, and then Sweden, Poland will take some territory. The boyars choose Michael Romanov as their czar, and this will be the beginning of the Romanov family. So they restores, I think I said the Romanov family earlier, I apologize, the Romanov family now, sorry about that. And this will start your Romanov family. Restores order, expels the invaders, and takes part of the Ukraine. And so again, continuing to expand for Russia. The borders will extend to the Ottoman region. Alexei Romanov, church purge of Mongol era innovations, old believers exiled. And so the Mongols, who had tolerated many religions, had adopted a lot of different aspects into the church, and so all of those old traditions were expelled. So the old believers were those that had the mixed traditions from Mongol religions with the Orthodox, and they were expelled. All right, the Tsar's autocracy of Peter the Great, policies, autocratic ruler, reforms, secret police, conflict with the Ottomans, Baltic port achieved, capital St. Petersburg. All right, so he's had an autonomous rule, and so he was ruling as the ultimate ruler. He will have sweeping reforms. He will have a secret police that is going to last all the way into the 20th century. And they will have conflicts with the Ottoman Empire, especially bordering those Baltic regions and the northern Middle East area. They will have conflicts with them. The Baltic ports achieved, this is important because this gives them a port without ice, so kind of a warm weather port, so to speak. But they're not having to deal with solid ice, and so they're able to have shipping and trade. And the capital will be moved to St. Petersburg, which is very close to that region. And that will become the center of Russia during this time period. Again, here's another map. You can see St. Petersburg. There's some connections up in here for some waterways. Here's the Baltic Sea that they will gain. They will gain that from Sweden, who is a strong European power at that time. All right, what Westernization meant, bureaucratic changes. Peter the Great's going to do most of the Westernization. The book said he goes incognito over into Western Europe and is going to bring back a lot of the ideas. Catherine the Great will do the same. The thing that was that helped the Russians when they were doing this is they were selective of what they brought over, so they still kept their traditions and they weren't the ones being assimilated into Western Europe. The Navy was created, Council of Nobles was ended, replaced by Dependent Advisors. So again, trying to get rid of the noble aspects so you're not fighting over the heir of who's going to rule. Providential governors under central control, so somewhat trying to get some centralization here. Nothing compared to what we've seen in the past in some other countries. Town councils under royal authority and laws codified. So this helps out having the same laws from town to town, so you're having some unification. Economy, obviously metal and mining with their industries, which will eventually lead into their power in iron and steel. Pressures to use serfs in manufacturing, and this will be the beginning of their course of labor. Culture, nobles forced to shave beards and wear Western dress, and so obviously trying to have that more sophisticated look of the West. Education improved in math, also in the sciences and in the literature as well. Upper class only affected though. This does not trickle down. They don't have a strong middle class, which hurts them in manufacturing. And then you have your peasantry. And so most of the Westernization is going to take place among your upper class. Consolidation under Catherine the Great. All right, Peter dies in 1724. Some weak rulers are going to follow. Catherine the Great will come to power, the widow of Peter the Third. Pugachev is a peasant rebellion, and she's able to put that down. She does bring in Westernization. She's a patron of the arts. Absolutism. Again, so having that autocratic ruler, nobles empowered over the serfs. This is where she will actually kind of give a little bit of power. Even though she typically was a strong ruler, there were some things where she's going to let some of the nobles gain some power back just because it made life easier for her. One of those being in charge of the serfs. The French Revolution, causes for reaction. This is where Westernization was selective. They didn't allow the literature of that time period to come into Russia. They didn't allow ideologies and other aspects of Western Europe to come over into Russia because they didn't want that to spark any kind of revolution. And we'll be looking at the French Revolution in a couple chapters. Expansion, the Crimean take from the Turks, so you have the Crimean War, Siberia, they'll take more of those areas, Alaska's claim, even all the way down to Northern California that they will end up exploring and controlling. Explorers into Northern California and partition of Poland, there'll be three partitions of Poland, and then Poland will obviously no longer be Poland, it will be part of Russia. All right, serfdom, the life of Eastern Europe's masses. Enserfment under the Mongols, it did start under there. You'll also see some glimpse of serfdom under the Roman Empire. So there's kind of been this idea of serfdom for a while. Obviously, we saw it in Europe much earlier, and now we're seeing it in Russia during this time period. 1649, serfdom becomes hereditary, so you're born into serfdom. It's almost slavery in a way. They were allowed to treat their serfs, the masters were allowed to treat their serfs harshly. They were allowed to be punished. They were stuck to their land. Very difficult conditions to get out of. Later laws decreased peasants' rights and mobility. Conditions deteriorated in the 18th century. Trade and economic dependence, 95% was rural, small merchant class. The main thing that they were trading was grain, and that grain was going to the West. They didn't have a major manufacturing industry at this time period. Holdings by 1800, again, good idea to see the growth of a country. Social unrest, call for reform by 1800s, peasants were unrest, landlords blamed for difficulties, the Pugachev rebellion, which was put down by Catherine the Great in the 1770s, that was the height of discontent. Russia and Eastern Europe, variations, the Balkans under the Ottomans, and so they were challenging the Ottomans in this area, trying to gain the Black Sea, so that way they had an area to the south as well. Influenced by the Enlightenment, again, ideas starting to come over, having to regulate those, especially under Catherine the Great. Several states lose autonomy. Poland, obviously, with the partition. You obviously have the Catholic difference with the Orthodox in some of these areas, and the weakness leads to partitions with Poland. And then here's a map concluding the growth of Russia, and that will end where we are at this time. We will pick Russia back up, and we'll see some of their industrialization later on in comparison with Japan. But all of this would have been setting the stage for that. And so that concludes chapter 18.